Welcome to Living in the Path. This is a module on the seven limb prayer. So the seven limb prayer is a very common prayer that we find at the beginning of many practices or meditations or rituals. It's there, it's very common. And it's one of the six preliminaries of the Lamrim. Like when we study the Lamrim, it is explained how to do a meditation session on the Lamrim. And so there are these six preliminaries that first you clean the place where you're going to practice, then you arrange the altar, or if you have your altar already, then it's okay, the altar is there. Then you arrange some offerings on the altar. Then you take the right posture, physical posture. Then you generate the right mental disposition, the right, you take refuge and you generate bodhicitta. And then after you visualize the marriage field and you offer the seven limb prayer. And after that, you ask the blessings of the guru. So the seven limb prayer, you do this prayer in front of the merit field. So the merit field, there are different ways of visualizing the merit field. Merit field means that normally the usual field is a field from where you grow crops, and this is a field from where you grow merit. So there are elaborate ways of visualizing a merit field, and if you know how to do this, you can do the elaborate visualization. But also you can just visualize the space, all the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas of the 10 directions in the space in front of you. Or you can also visualize very simply, like we say, all into one, visualize the Buddha in front of you. The Buddha who is one with your teacher. And then you offer the seven limb prayer to this Buddha who is your teacher. So there are different versions of the seven limb prayer. The main purpose of the seven limb prayer is to accumulate merit and to purify negativities. So the idea is like if you want to grow a crop, same. If you want a crop from the field, you know, it's if you have a field which is filled with stones and bushes or garbage or weeds and you plant your seeds, you have very little chance to get a good crop. So you need to clean up your field before and get rid of all this. So purifying, the practice of purifying is the same, the idea is the same. You have to get rid of everything which obstructs the mind to grow the spiritual realization. And then also you need to grow the merit, you need the merit to develop realizations, spiritual realizations. Just like in the field, it's not enough to plant your seeds. You also need to have all the conditions. You need to have the warmth, to have the water, to have the fertilizer for the, and have a good rich earth to grow your crop. So here's the same, you need to have all the conditions in your mind and you need the merit, which is like the good karma or the spiritual strength that will make it that you can grow the realizations. So there are different versions of the seven limb prayer, and some are very elaborate, and actually each practice could have also different practices or different sadhanas or different rituals could have their own seven limb prayer. For example, one which is very used and very beautiful also, it's all the beginning of the King of Prayer, the aspiration of the practice of Samatabhadra. So all the beginning of this is seven limb prayer, and sometimes it is used, for example, sometimes when His Holiness the Dalai Lama give bodhisattva vows or give some initiation, then they will do as a preliminary also they will do these 17 prayers, which is a bit elaborate. Also, for example, in the Lama Chopa, which is a ritual that we do often, all the first part of the Lama Chopa is just a 7-limb prayer. And it starts the actual practice. I remember a commentary with His Holiness saying, actually, verse 43, you request the guru, requests the blessing of the guru, and that's the actual practice. So all the beginning is a 7-limb prayer. So here in this module, Lama Zopa Rinpoche explained the 7-limb prayer, which is like the very simple version, with one line for each practice. So 7-limb prayer, that means a set of 7 practices. So these are first the prostration, then we make offerings, then after we confess negativities, then we rejoice in merits, and then we request the Buddha Guru to remain long in sacred existence, and then the sixth one is that we request the Guru Buddha to grant teachings, to turn the wheel of Dharma, which means actually to grant teachings, and 7-1 is a dedication. So we are going to look at the 7 practices. The first one is the prostration. Yeah? So respectfully, I prostrate with my body, speech, and mind. So we offer prostration, physical prostration, and then verbal, that means we can see some prayer, some praise to the Buddha, and mentally we develop respect, the mental attitude of respect. And so physically we also prostrate. So physical prostration, there are different types. One is a long prostration where you just lay down completely. Then the short prostration where you just put 4 limbs on the ground. That means you have to have the 2 knees and 2 hands and the forehead touching the ground. This is a short one. And then there is a very simple prostration of just putting your hand together with a respectful attitude. And so this is a simple one. So this prostration, the practice of prostration purifies all the negativities of body, speech, and mind. And then the result is that you will obtain all the qualities of the body, speech, and mind of a Buddha. So the prostration purifies pride. It's an antidote to the delusion of pride. So we can understand that, because when you do prostration, somehow you take a low place, you just go down, you know, with your body. So that counteracts pride, because with pride it's like we have an inflated ego. The I is very important, so to go down it kind of deflates the ego. Also with the prostration you express respect, and so expressing respect means that you recognize the qualities, you know, the qualities of the object of your prostration. And with pride, actually, it's difficult to recognize the qualities of others, because we think we're the best, you know. So in that way, prostration is the antidote to pride. And then after, and then after we have the practice of offering. So I offer clouds of every type of offering, actual and imagined. So you offer, you make offerings of what is arranged in your altar and or in your house, and also everything that you imagine. Actually, when you make offering, you visualize all the sky, all field of all filled with different types of offerings. Like usually we would have all the objects of senses, like in the what we offer in the water bowls, like the water and incense, light, perfume, food, music, etc. So you can visualize all beautiful things that you want to offer. So offering is an antidote to miserliness. So that we can understand, because with miserliness, actually the mind is very tight. We hold on things like we have, like resources are limited. So miserliness is a cause for poverty, for lack, for scarcity. Actually, with miserliness, we create scarcity. And with offering, it's completely the contrary. You know, we visualize all these beautiful things, then we offer to the Buddha. Then the Buddha, we visualize all these offerings are in the nature of bliss, and the Buddha accepts them, you know, and generate very lot of happiness from these offerings. So we visualize all these beautiful things, and then we give them away. We give them, you know. So actually, with this, we create abundance in our mind. And so this is a cause to receive actually skies of enjoyment. So the next one is the practice of confession. So I declare all my negativities and downfalls accumulated since beginningless lives. So when we do the confession, we confess everything we remember, but many things we don't remember, of course. So it's good, actually, we think I've done everything since many lives, beginningless life. I've done all kinds of negativities, I've done everything. And so the confession purifies the negative karma and the delusions, so especially what we call the three poisons, the ignorance and aversion and attachment. And so the main thing when we do the confession, we use the four powers of purification. And of course, Rinpoche explains everything about all these practices. But the main one of these four powers is regret. So when you do the confession, many what you do is that you declare, you know, you acknowledge that you have done all these negative things. And so we acknowledge them, we don't hide them, we don't keep them, you know, inside. So we declare, I've done everything, you know, you put it out into the open. And then we regret having done them, you know. And that purifies with the other powers also. It's a little bit like, for example, if I have done something wrong towards somebody, for example, I have insulted somebody, then I go and I apologize to this person. Yeah. I go and apologize. I recognize I've done something and I express my regret to the person, you know. So then this person's, the anger of this person kind of get less or pacify, disappear, you know. So I kind of undo what I've done. Yeah. So the confession is a little bit the same, expressing the regret, yeah, and then deciding not to commit again. This is confession. And the next practice is the practice of rejoicing. Yeah. So I rejoice in all the virtues of Aryas and ordinary beings. So we rejoice in the virtues of the good actions of oneself and others. So others are ordinary beings and all beings on different levels of the path, and also the Buddhas. We rejoice in the qualities of the Buddhas and our teachers, and this creates a cause for oneself getting this all these qualities, receiving all these qualities. So we rejoice in the virtuous actions, good actions, in and also in the result. The result of good action is happiness. We also rejoice in the happiness that we see around us, the temporary happiness, the ultimate happiness. So rejoicing is a way of accumulating merit, and we all need merits. Yeah, it's very important to accumulate merit, because we need merit, whatever we want. If we want happiness, if we want success, if we want enjoyment, then we need merit. Like, for example, if you want to get a job, you need merit. And also, if you want spiritual realizations, then we need merit. Yeah. And rejoicing in all the good qualities and all the virtues of others and oneself, you know, is a way of creating merit, and very easy way of creating merit. You know? So, for example, very easy, you can think all the condition, all the good condition that I have in my life now, you know. So all this comes because I have creating all this good karma in the past, you know. So it's wonderful, wonderful, you know, all these good actions. So in the past, in the present, in the future, yeah, we rejoice in the virtue of the three times. And then we think about all the good actions that people do in the world, you know. So I've done, do, and will do. Yeah. So it's a very easy way of accumulating merit, because you don't need to do anything special, you know. It's just something that you do mentally with your mind. So you could be in your car driving, or having a walk, or being on, in the beach, you know, and doing this practice of rejoicing. So it's a very important practice. And so it is an antidote to jealousy. Yeah? Because with jealousy, actually, we resent others' goodness and others' happiness. So jealousy kind of make the mind, bring the mind down. Yeah? Bring the mind down. And make you depressed, yeah? And rejoicing creates a lot of joy, and makes you a country, makes you happy. Yeah? So this is rejoicing. And the next practice is a practice to request the Buddha, who is your teacher, to remain until the end of samsara. So actually, this is a request for the teacher to have a stable life. So when you do this practice, you visualize offering to the Buddha a throne, a golden throne. Then you offer it, you know, then at the end you visualize this throne absorbed into him. So this purifies the karma of having disturbed the holy mind of the teacher. And also the karma of not meeting a teacher in future lives. And so the result is that you will find a teacher, and yourself will have a long life, and also that you will obtain the holy body of Buddha. And then the next practice is a request to turn the wheel of Dharma. So when you do this request, turning the wheel of Dharma, which means request to the teacher for teachings, and you offer a Dharma chakra, a Dharma wheel, a golden Dharma wheel, like radiating with light. And so you offer that to the teacher when you do this request. So this purify ignorance. And it purifies also the negative karma of having abandoned the Dharma. So we abandon the Dharma, for example, when we study the Dharma and we find something which we don't understand, very difficult to understand. And then we say, for example, we say, oh, this is useless for me, you know, I don't need this. It's completely useless, and leave it aside, you know. So this is abandoning the Dharma. So it's okay to leave it aside for the time being, thinking I will understand it later, you know, but not rejecting, saying, oh, this is meaningless, you know. So it purifies this kind of karma to request the teacher to turn the wheel of Dharma. And so the result of this practice is that you will receive teachings also in future life. You will meet the Dharma in future lives, and you will reach the holy speech of a Buddha. It's also a cause for yourself to be able to teach the Dharma. So the last practice is the practice of the dedication. So I dedicate all the merits to the great enlightenment. So when we dedicate the merit, we dedicate the merits of the three times, of the past, present, and future merits, and we dedicate also our own merits, and then merits of all beings, all sentient beings, and all the Buddhas, and we dedicate to reach enlightenment for the benefit of all beings. So dedicating our merits after practice is to prevent that this merit be destroyed, and especially being destroyed by anger or very negative state of mind that can destroy all our positive merits that we just created, especially created with all these practices that we have done before: prostration, the offering, confession, rejoicing, the request. So to preserve this from being destroyed by anger, we dedicate them. And so the result of this is that we will receive all the qualities of the Buddha, we will reach enlightenment. So in this module, Lama Zopa Rinpoche explained all these practices with many details and explained how to do it. And there is also a guideline how to do the practice. And of course, as always, Rinpoche explained everything very thoroughly, very perfectly. Yeah, and you will find also some mindfulness practice for each of these limbs, and that helps you actually to carry this practice through the day, not just when you are on the cushion, but also in your day with all the activities that you're doing. So I wish you good study and practice of the seven limbs.